Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Balabha Girivaradari. Gopi Jana Balabha Girivaradari. Jasoda Nandana Braja Jana Randana. Jasoda Nandana Braja Jana Randana. Jamuna Tiravana Chari. Jamuna Tiravana Chari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Balabha Girivaradari. Gopi Jana Balabha Girivaradari. Jasoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jasoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Tiravana Chari. Jamuna Tiravana Chari. Jai Om Vishnupad Paramahamsa Parivarajakacharya Asacharya Satyashri Srimadis Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj Prabhupada Ki Jai. ISKCON Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Nantukoti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Shikaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Dvaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Go Gopinath Shyamakunda Radha Kunda Giri Govardhana Ki Jai. Vrindavan Dhamma Ki Jai, Mathura Dhamma Ki Jai, Navadvipa Mayapur Dhamma Ki Jai, Jagannath Puri Dhamma Ki Jai, Gangamai Jamuna Devi Ki Jai, Bhakti Devi Ki Jai, Tulsi Maharani Ki Jai, Samaveta Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai, Gaur Premanande. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namane Namaste Sarasvati Deve Gauravani Pacharne Nivasesa Sanyavadi Paskachyade Sitarane Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavam Shri Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Samsachivam Sadvoitam Sadvadutam Padichana Sahita Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakam Vitamscha Panchakalpa Chubhisha Kripasindaviva Chapati Janam Pavanevyo Vaishnava Namaha. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. June 15, 2016, at Soho Street in London, reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 3, Liberation from the Illusory Energy, Text 35. Sri Pipalayan Uvacha. Stityud bhava pralaya hetur ahetu asya. Yat swapna jagira shusupti shusad bahischa. Dehendriya shuridayani charanti yena. Sanjivitani taravehi param narendra. Please chant. That worked very well. We try that again, maybe.
Yasvatna
jagara
Pipalayana Uvacha. Sri Pipalayana said, Stiti, of the creation, Udbhava, maintenance, Pralaya, and destruction, Hetu, the cause, Ahetu, itself without cause, Asya, of this material universe, Yat, which, Swapna, in dream, Jagara, wakefulness, Sushuptishu, in deep sleep or unconsciousness, Sat, which exists, Bahicha, and external to them as well, Deha, of the material bodies of the living entities, Indriya, the senses, Asu, life airs, Vridayani, and minds, Charni, Charanti, act, Yena, by which, Samjivitani, given life, Tat, that, Avehi, please know, Param, to be the supreme, Nara Indra, O King. Translation, Sri Pipalayana said, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, I'm going to ask you what he said, but I guess you can see it there. So, right. Supreme Personality of Godhead is the cause of the creation, maintenance, and destruction of this universe, yet he has no prior cause. He pervades the various states of wakefulness, dreaming, and unconscious deep sleep, and also exists beyond them. By entering the body of every living being as a super soul, he enlivens the body, senses, life air, and mental activities, and thus all the subtle and gross organs of the body begin their functions. My dear King, know that personality of Godhead to be the Supreme. So does this go scroll through the purport too? It's a very long purport, and it's very technical and very philosophical, and please don't think about what's going to be for breakfast and what you have to do at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and just please try to be attentive. I know this is not an easy kind of purport to be attentive to, but please try. I'd like you to see if you can figure out what are the main points here. Purport. In the previous verse, King Nimmi inquired about various aspects of the Absolute Truth, namely Narayana, Brahman, and Paramatma. Now the sage Sri Pipalayana explains these three features of the Absolute Truth in the same order in which the king mentioned them. Stiti, Ubaya, Pralaya, Hetu refers to the Supreme Personality of Godhead who expands himself as the triple Purusha incarnations, Mahavishnu, Garbhadakshaya Vishnu, and Kshiradakshaya Vishnu. Okay, why? Why would Stiti, Ubaya, Pralaya, Hetu refer to Mahavishnu, Garbhadakshaya Vishnu, and Kshiradakshaya Vishnu? And maintenance. So which one would mean maintenance? Of these, Stiti, Ubaya, Pralaya. Stiti. How do you know Stiti means maintenance?
Stable.
Good. It actually has to do with the word stable in English. Okay. Pralaya means destruction, and Ubaya? No, Stiti is maintenance, creation. And why would this refer to Mahavishnu, Garbhadakshay Vishnu, and Kshiradakshay Vishnu? They're all the cause of creation, and they're also the cause of destruction and maintenance, isn't it? Who particularly here is in maintenance of the three? Kshiradaksha Vishnu. As described in the Bhagavatam 1.3.1, Jagrahe Protosham Rupam Bhagavan Mahad Adi Bhi Sambhutam Shodashakalam Ado Loka Sishrikshaya. In the beginning of the creation, the Lord first expanded himself in the universal form of the Purusha incarnation and manifested all the ingredients for the material creation. So they're giving evidence that this applies to the three Vishnus. And thus, at first, there was the creation of the 16 principles of material action. This was for the purpose of creating the material universe. What are the 16? And then what would be the 16th? This was for the purpose of creating the material universe. Thus, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayan, is mentioned here as Hetuhu, or the supreme cause of the creation, maintenance, and annihilation of the cosmic situation. Still, there is no cause of the Lord himself. He is Ahetu. So in the Sanskrit it says, Hetur Ahetu. As expressed in the Brahma Samhita, Anadir Adi Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. Why is they quoting that? Sarva Karana Karanam, cause of all causes. But it's specifically in response to Hetur Ahetur. Why are they quoting Anadir Adir Govinda? Well, not no end is not mentioned here. Anadir Adir. Without beginning is Anadir, and Adir is the beginning. So he has no beginning, but he is the beginning of everything. So Anadir Adir, he has no beginning, but he's the beginning of everything, is the same as Hetu Ahetu. He is the cause of everything, but it's in reverse order. Yes, very much like that. Except this is the beginning and end, but this is not saying end right here. What it's saying is the beginning of everything who has no beginning himself. Okay, good. The Supreme Lord is the cause of all causes, and being the eternal absolute truth, he has no cause of himself. The word Ahetu has also been explained by Srila Jiva Goswami to indicate that the Supreme Lord has his original form as Krishna in his own transcendental abode called Krishna Loka. Since Krishna is always engaged in his blissful pastimes in the company of his eternally liberated associates, he is aloof from the affairs of this world, which is created by his external potency known as Maya. So here's another meaning of the word Ahetu, that he's not the cause. He's not the cause because he's aloof. He's doing something else. He's somewhere else doing something else, and he has nothing to do with it. So he's aloof. Therefore, it is stated, Jagrahe Purusham Rupam. The Lord expands himself as Narayan and Vishnu to facilitate the gross illusion and gradual rectification of the conditioned souls. The Lord's aloofness. So as Narayana and Vishnu, he's the Hetu, he's the cause. As Krishna, he's the Ahetu. He's not the cause. So it can also be explained like this. The Lord's aloofness from the material creation is also described in the Vedas. Natasya karyam karanam cha vidyate. The absolute truth has nothing to do, since everything is done self-sufficiently by his multipotencies. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur has pointed out that even though the Supreme Lord Krishna is ahetu, or causeless, and aloof from the cause of the material creation, the Lord is also described in this verse as hetu, or the ultimate cause of the creation, maintenance, and annihilation of the material manifestation, because he expands himself as the Paramatma, or the Supersoul, who acts as the prime mover of the cosmic manifestation. Which of the three Vishnus is the Supersoul? The word Ahetu may also be understood in another way. In the Bhagavad Gita 7.5, the Lord says, Aparyeham itas tvanyam, Prakritim vidime param jiva bhuta mahabaho yayedam daryate jagat. The conditioning living entities jiva bhuta desire to engage in sense gratification with their material senses, manasastranindriyani prakriti stani karshati. Thus, the creation of the material world becomes necessary. In fact, the material cosmic manifestation continues to exist because of the desires of the conditioned souls to exploit it. Yaye dam daryate jagat. Why does the material world exist? Because we want it, our desire. The government must create a prison to accommodate those citizens who are inclined to criminal activity. There is no need for any citizen to live in the obnoxious condition of the prison, but because a certain portion of the population is inclined towards antisocial behavior, the prison becomes necessary. In a higher sense, the prisoners themselves can be considered the hetu, or the cause, for the construction of the prison. So here, God is considered not the cause, because who is the cause? The living entities. Similarly, the Supreme Personality of Godhead expands his internal potency according to his own desire to increase the ananda, or transcendental bliss, of himself and his pure devotees, but he manifests the material universe in response to the illicit desires of the conditioned souls to live a life of sense gratification in willful forgetfulness of him. Therefore, the conditioned living entities themselves can be considered the hetu, or cause, of the material manifestation. The external potency of the Lord Maya, who is charged with the duty of material manifestation, is called Chaya, or the shadow of the Lord's internal potency. Srishti stiti pralaya sadhana shaktireka chayeva yastu bhuvanani bivarti durga. That's from? The Lord does not personally desire to manifest the shadow potency called Durga or Maya. The blissful spiritual planets eternally manifest contain the best possible facilities for the living entities who are parts and parcels of the Lord. But the conditioned souls, rejecting the inconceivable eternal living arrangements the Lord has kindly provided, prefer to seek their misfortune in the shadow kingdom called the material world. Thus, both Durga and the conditioned living entities may be considered the hetu, or cause, of the material manifestation. So not only the living entities can be considered the cause, but also Durga, or the shadow. Since Lord Krishna is ultimately Sarvakarana Karanam, the cause of all causes, he is to be known as the ultimate supreme cause. But how the Lord's functions as a supreme cause of the material manifestation, Stiti Ubaya Pralaya Hetu, which is from this verse, is described in the 13th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Upadrista Numanta Cha. The Lord acts as overseer and permitter. So drasta means to see, and upa means above. What we have in English, we have the word what?
Overseer,
or supervisor, or supervision, right? It's very similar to this word, upadrasta. The Lord acts as overseer and permitter. The actual desire of the Supreme Personality of Godhead is stated very clearly in Bhagavad Gita, Sarva Dharman Pritcha Jama may come sharanam praja. The Lord desires every living entity to give up the shadow potency Maya and return to the actual substance, Vastavam Vastu, which is the eternal kingdom of God. Although various aspects of the Absolute Truth are being described, the Absolute Truth is ultimately one, as stated in this verse, Tat Avehi Param Narendra. King Nimi inquired about Brahman, and now this verse says, Tat Swapna Jagara Susuptishu Sad Bahis Cha. So what does Swapna mean?
Dream.
Jagara. Susupti. Deep sleep. And what does bahi mean? Bahir nisingo ridaye nishingo. Outside. The Lord's all-pervading feature within wakefulness, dreaming, and deep sleep, and his existence beyond these three mental states, are understood to be manifestation of Brahman, the spiritual potency of the Lord. Finally, the statement, dehendriyashu ridayani charati yena sanjivitani. What does deha mean? Body, indriya, rida, heart. Sanjivitani, jiva's life, can be understood to refer to the paramatma feature of the Lord. When the Lord expands himself as Sirodakshai Vishnu, the third of the three Vishnu features, and enters the heart of every living entity, the gross and subtle organs of the body become enlivened for continuing the chain of fruitive activity called karma. According to Srila Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur, the multifarious manifestations of the Supreme Personality of Godhead do not comprise his supremacy as one without a second. The Absolute Truth is Paravyomanata, or the Lord of the spiritual sky. So Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur is saying that the Lord is Brahman and Paramatma is not really the full absolute truth. The full absolute truth is Parvyoma Nata, the Lord of the greater sky. The Lord of the spiritual sky, who appears as two-armed Shyamasundar, as four-armed, as eight-armed, or as having 1,000 arms. In each aspect, his body is eternal and full of bliss and knowledge, Satchidanandamurti. He appears on earth as Vasudev, and within the causal ocean as Mahavishnu. He lies on the milk ocean as Siradakashai Vishnu, and rescues his helpless young devotee as Nisingadev. Appearing as Lord Ramachandra, he acts as a perfect king. And appearing as Krishna, he steals the hearts of everyone, and especially of young, beautiful women. All these features of the Lord are indicated by the word Narayana, or the Supreme Personality of Godhead, just as the word president indicates not only the official duties of the president, but his personal family life and long, intimate friendships as well. According to Srimad Bhagavatam, Krishna is true Bhagavan Swayam. When one transcends an official understanding of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and comes to the superior status of love of God, one can understand the Lord to be Krishna, the cause of all causes. The innumerable Vishnu expansions of the Lord are also understood to be plenary portions of Sri Krishna, Krishna's true Bhagavan Swayam. As the Lord himself states in Bhagavad Gita, Aham Sarvasya Prabhupada. These points have been explicitly clarified in the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, as well as in the opening verse, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Janmadhyasya Yato, Navad Itaratas Charteshu. Sri Pipalayana Uvacha, Stit Yubaya, Pralaya, Hetur Ahetur Asya, Yat Swapna Jagarasasup, Tishusad Bahischa, Dehendriyashu Ridayani Charantiyena, Sanjivitani Tadaveha Param Narendra. Sri Pipalayana said, the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the cause of the creation, maintenance, and destruction of this universe, yet he has no prior cause. He pervades the various states of wakefulness, dreaming, and unconscious deep sleep, and also exists beyond them. By entering the body of every living being as a supersoul, he enlivens the body, senses, life, air, and mental activities, and thus all the subtle and gross organs of the body begin their functions. My dear King, know that Supreme Personality to be, of Godhead to be the Supreme. So our purpose in life is to know what is true. Why do we have to know what's true? Why does it matter? Because we're an illusion. Well, we can't know that until we know what's true. That's kind of part of the whole thing. No, it's a cold, the end of a cold. We're just lingering. Yes?
We're looking for real happiness, but we don't want it to be based on a false platform.
Okay, very nice. So we're all looking for happiness. Is everybody looking for happiness? Yes. Who here would like to be miserable? Anybody? No. Okay, so we'd all like to be happy. Everyone would like to be happy. Yes, in the United States, in our Constitution, actually in the Declaration of Independence, it says that everyone has the right to pursue happiness. Interestingly enough, it doesn't say everyone has the right to find it. It just says everyone has the right to look for it. So we all want to find happiness. We don't just want to look for it. We want to find it. And how can you find happiness unless you know what's real and what's not real? Does that make sense to everybody? Right? Can I find happiness in something that's not real?
Yes.
I can. You're telling me I can find happiness. Okay, can you give me an example of finding happiness in something that's not real?
Video games.
A video game. Okay. Would you say that that gives you actual happiness?
No.
Why not? Why not? Because
relief.
Does it actually give you relief? Does a video game or a movie or a TV show or intoxication? It probably corrupts you and numbs your brain. But why can't it give you happiness? Any of those things, which are all, by any estimation, not real. I mean, they're real in the sense the video game has some existence. It's ones and zeros. It's metal and plastic. It's electricity. It exists, but it's not what it appears to be.
They don't last.
They don't last. Okay. The happiness doesn't last. That's one way you can tell that it's not real happiness. Real happiness is something that lasts. How else would you say it's not real happiness?
It covers the happiness of
the soul. Okay, but that's assuming that there's a happiness of a soul. I mean, that's an excellent answer, but it's making a strong assumption. Yes?
Kind of, you finish the game, then that's it.
You have to buy another game. Very much like that it's temporary. It's limited. Okay, it's limited. It's limited. You reach the end of it. That's not the kind of happiness we want. We don't want happiness that ends and has a limit, correct? I mean, we tolerate that because that's what seems to be available. But it's not what we want. Wouldn't we all like happiness that continues without limit? Yes. So in that way, it's not actually satisfying. And in that way, we can tell it's not real. So this is a little subtle but quite important. The fact that we all want happiness without end. Everybody wants happiness without end, right? If you asked anybody, would you like happiness without end? They would say yes. They might say, well, that's not possible here. But would they say they want it? Yes, they want it. So where would that desire come from? If all there was happiness that has an end, if that's all that existed, where would the desire for limitless happiness come from? So just like there's some creatures suited to live in the desert that never, they don't drink water, they don't need to drink water. So they don't have any desire to drink water. But those of us who are creatures who are designed to drink water, when we're in a desert, we have a desire to drink water. The desire to drink water in a place where there's no water is indicative that it is our natural state to drink water. Does this make sense to everybody? Yes. So the fact that we all have a desire for happiness without end indicates that that is our natural state. It's a universal desire. So things that are false can't give us that. There's nothing false that can give you something limitless, some kind of limitless happiness. Also, something false can't give you happiness because it's not giving any happiness to you. So if in the video game or the movie or the TV show, somebody makes a lot of money, do you make a lot of money? No, if your character that you're manipulating in the computer game, if they win the treasure, have you won any treasure? No. If the character in the video game or the movie or the TV show, they find, you know, their most ideal romantic partner, have you found your most ideal romantic partner? No. You know, you turn off the show, you get off the video game, and you're still alone in the house with your cats, right? And nothing has changed. So, therefore, it's not... Things that are false cannot give you real happiness, right? And one devotee told me many years ago, he said, you know, when you turn off the TV, you actually feel worse. Because all of a sudden, you're comparing yourself to this standard of happiness. And when you turn it off, you realize that none of that is actually touching you. So in order to be happy, we have to know what's true. Another reason we have to know what's true in order to be happy is, how do you know what decisions to make? This is very practical. How do you know? Should I have this job or that job? Should I study in this university or that university? What should I study? Should I marry or not? If I marry, who should I marry? Should I have children or not? How many children? Should I live here? Should I live there? And even simple things like, what should I wear in the morning? What should I eat? Right? If you want to decide what to eat, don't you have to know what is and is not nourishing for your body? Yes? Do you have to know that information in order to gain happiness from what you eat? Very simple. So if you don't know what's true and what's false, you can't make good decisions, and you can't experience happiness. So is this reasonable to everybody? Okay, so we want to know the truth. So this verse is about knowing the truth. That's what this verse is about. It's not just some theoretical, philosophical thing that doesn't have anything to do with us, and we're just going to go and eat our chapatis afterwards and distribute these books that have all this philosophical stuff that has nothing to do with us. So that's not what it's about. This verse is about knowing what is true. In order to know what's true, I have to know what is absolutely true. Just knowing a relative truth is not enough. I have to know what's absolutely true. And I've heard people object and say, well, you guys talk about the absolute truth, that means you're very sectarian. Well, no, what we mean by absolute truth is something that is non-contextual. It's true in all times, in all places, in all circumstances. There's a lot of truth that's true. It's relative truth. It's contextual truth. Actually, even the scripture is full of contextual truth, isn't it? Yes? In fact, most of the scripture is full of contextual truth. When Krishna says to Arjuna, for those who have been honored, dishonor is worse than death. And then he says, be detached from what? Honor and dishonor. Don't be dishonored now. It'll be worse than death. Actually, don't care about dishonor. So those are both contextual statements. They have to be. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. So those are important things to know. But more important to know than that is that which is above any kind of context. And that is the description of the Lord himself and the relationship of the Lord to the world and the relationship of the Lord to us. And it is said that when we know this, we know everything. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that you will know how to spell discombobulated. It doesn't necessarily mean you'll know what to do when your car breaks down in the middle of the street. It doesn't mean that you'll know that kind of thing. When we say one who knows Krishna knows everything, you may not know how to fix a carburetor. You may not know how to speak Swahili. I mean, that's not what it means. But what it does mean is that you'll see the basic, it's called the warp and the weft. You'll see that the threads under everything, the Lord is compared to the horizontal and the vertical threads in a piece of cloth. And you will understand the basis of everything. You will understand the non-contextual, trans-contextual truth of everything. And understanding the truth of everything, we'll be able to find what we seek. We will know things as they are. So the first time I met Srila Prabhupada in Chicago in 1974, my father was asking Prabhupada, can I come to the temple even if I'm not a devotee of Krishna? And Prabhupada said, yes. He said, doesn't matter what religion you are. The purpose is to know God and to love him. So this verse is very much about knowing God. Very much about knowing God. At the end of the purport, there's some discussion about loving God. So let's see if we can find out something about truth. Huh? What do you say? You ready? Interested? At least slightly more interested than you were before we began this long, 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 very complex philosophical purport. All right, so first of all, the absolute truth is the cause of creation, maintenance, and destruction. So there are many religions that do not credit God with destruction, or do not credit God even with maintenance. So there are religions who say God created everything, and then he went off and did something else. I mean, look, we do that kind of thing, right? We create something, and then we walk away and leave it. And whatever happens, happens. There's a member, Akura Prabhu. Most of you know Akura Prabhu. Does he still pop into Soho from time to time? So he recommended this book to me called Good to Great by, I think, Jim Collins, which is one of the, you know, seminal works in the management world. And it was an analysis of businesses that had a huge increase in their profitability. I was just looking at it from a monetary point of view. And what took these companies from being good companies to great companies, especially those that sustained their economic greatness. So one of them was that the leaders took responsibility. And they took responsibility for the succession of the business. They made sure that there was a succession plan. And companies that became great and then dropped off as soon as the leader left, they hadn't done that. So there were some leaders who wanted to be the big cheese, you know, when we say the big kahuna. They wanted to be the person in charge. They wanted it to be a personality cult. They wanted it to be about them. So they brought their company to greatness. And as soon as they retired or died, everything fell apart. And they didn't care. They didn't matter to them. They weren't concerned about the company. They were concerned about themselves. They wanted the company to be great as an extension of themselves. And then the other companies had leaders who all the time they were in a leadership position gave all the credit for the company's success to other members of the company. If anything went wrong, they took the blame. If anything went right, they gave the credit to everyone else. And they had a clear succession plan. And to them, it was about the company. It wasn't about themselves. Of course, we see this with Srila Prabhupada, who in 1970 stepped out of the center of ISKCON and put instead the GBC as management. And Prabhupada had always had Krishna as the center of ISKCON. Yes? We talk about putting Prabhupada at the center. Srila Prabhupada always put Krishna at the center. Srila Prabhupada never put himself at the center. And even in terms of management, he very quickly got himself out of the key managerial position, which, by the way, had severe negative consequences for our movement as well, because he was putting people in top management positions who were only in their 20s and had only been chanting Hare Krishna for a few months and had no management or leadership training out in the world whatsoever. And some of these people made some pretty serious mistakes, the results of which we're still feeling now 50 years later, frankly. But he did that because he felt it was so important to get himself out of the center. So God is not the kind of God who just maintains and walks away and lets it fail and, you know, it only needs to be important while I'm hanging around. And as soon as I leave, then everything can fall apart. But there are many religions who talk about God like that, and they say that all the trouble in the world is because he's gone now. You know, he set it up and he's gone. Don't worry, he'll come back and fix it later. Right? Aren't there religions who say like that? God created everything and walked away and it all fell apart, and just hang on there, you know, he'll come back and fix it. You know, my aunt has cancer and she's dying. Well, too bad about that. But, you know, he'll come back after a while and fix everything. So this is one view. So we're saying God is not only the creator, but he's also the maintainer. He's maintaining as Vishnu. He's maintaining, as it says here, within everyone's heart, within all the atoms. Right? We say that the whole universe is the body of God. Maya tatamidam sarvam jagadavyaktimurtina. That everything is God, as Krishna says in the Chatur Sloka, before the creation I was there, during the creation there's only me, and after the creation there's also me. And destruction. So there are again many religions who don't credit God with destruction. All the destruction they credit to a second God that they call a devil, who's in competition with God. So all the disease and all the famine and all the warfare, anything that's destructive in the world. This is, doesn't just mean the big destruction at the very end, but all the little destructions. You know, even that we're getting old, right? I was at Rath Yatra and I was talking to the GBC Anuttama. Some of you have met him, right? Somebody walked up to him and said, "Oh, Anuttama Prabhu, is this your mother?" Wow. That would make me about 90, you know? And then we stayed briefly in the VIP room at the manor. And as I was walking down those spiral stairs, there was somebody walking with a bunch of kids, and some kid looks up and says, "Oh, the old lady's going to come and get me." I'm like, "Oh, man." Okay, Krishna's giving me some messages here. So these are little destructions. You know, little destructions. Your eyesight fails, your hair color fails, you know. You have to write on your driver's license, gray. You know, that was a real, it's like, gray? I was there with my daughter. I said, "Brown or gray?" She says, "Gray." You know, so all these little destructions, and they don't think that it's God that's doing that. They think it's some kind of devil that's doing that. You know, that if God were really in charge, these things wouldn't happen to people. So we're saying, no, he's in charge of destruction also. Creatance, maintenance, and destruction. And in fact, it's very interesting about even destruction. You know, Krishna has arranged the universe so that all the decaying things and the waste products become the fertilizer for life. Isn't that fascinating? You know? And I remember I was once talking to one devotee and said, you know, there's death because we can't fulfill all of our desires in one body. We have to die and forget and get another body for desires we can't fulfill in this body. I mean, some people now, they're trying to change their body in this life to fulfill their other desires. But that's not a very efficient or sane way to do it. Better just wait a little bit till you take your next body. He also said to me, he said, "Well, there's another reason." He said, "It's so that the young people get a chance to take over." And in fact, in Thomas Kuhn's book, Structure of Scientific Revolutions, he talks about that the only way that a paradigm really changes is the older people who hold on to that paradigm die. Because generally, once you've been invested in a paradigm, no matter what evidence you see to the contrary, you won't change it. So death allows for rebirth. The death of the older people allow the younger people a chance to do something. The manure allows the seeds to grow. The decaying tree allows the new seed to sprout. The winter leads to spring. So there's a cycle of destruction, which is part of creation. It's not simply destruction. And then also we say that the Lord is not the cause. So we say the Lord is the cause of creation, maintenance, and destruction. And we say, Ahetu, he's not the cause. He's not the cause because he is also aloof. He is transcendent. He really has nothing to do with the material world whatsoever. And Krishna simply is dancing with the gopis. He doesn't say, excuse me, Radharani, you know, I have to take care of John Smith on the earth planet in universe of the four-headed Brahma right now. You know, it's not like that. You know, Mother Yasoda, it's not Mother Yasoda just tying him up and he says, "Oh, wait, I just got a prayer request." You know, it's not like that. or, you know, oh, I've got to have, you know, an earthquake over here in that universe, and the universe of the ten-headed Brahma on that planet. I have to cause an earthquake right now. Excuse me, Mother Yasoda, I'll be right back. So Krishna is aloof. He's absorbed in his pastimes under Yogamaya. He's actually feeling afraid of Mother Yasoda. He's worried that Radharani won't see him. You know, he has another way that he's thinking, another absorption. So in that sense, he's not the cause at all. He's simply transcendent. He doesn't even create. He doesn't have anything to do with the world at all. And another way he's not the cause in that is that we're responsible for the existence of this world. It's our desires that have manifested the world, not his desires. It's not that Krishna doesn't want there to be an illusory energy, just like the government doesn't want there to be a prison. And parents don't, normal parents, they don't want to punish their children. They don't want to give their children a time out. You know, it's not that the builders of the house created the corner so the children would have a timeout place. You know, that wasn't the purpose of the corner. And they're not thinking like that. The parents wish that the children would always be well-behaved, and the government wishes that all the people would follow the laws, and Krishna wishes that all living entities would be eternally happy. So one can say that we're the cause, or one can say that it's the shadow of Krishna that's the cause. Chaya, Srishti Stiti Pralaya Sadhana Shakti Rekha. Chayeva Yastya Bhuvanani Bivarti Dura. Ichchani Rupam Iha Yastya. So he's the shadow, the Chaya. So it's just Krishna's shadow that's the cause, not Krishna himself. Or as Prabhupada would say, evil is the back of the Lord. Of course, Krishna's back is also very attractive. But one can say, in that way, he's not the cause. We can also say that not the cause simply means that Krishna has no cause. And that's a definition of God. That being beyond which there is nothing greater, and that being beyond which there is no cause. That God is the cause of himself. He is eternally existing and eternally expanding, and he's eternally expanding himself. And that is the very definition of God. If you say, how can there be a cause without a cause? Then you say, well, that is what we mean by God. And then another way that we can know God here is he exists within all states of consciousness. And we could talk about this for a very long time. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of time right now. Each of these we could be discussing for several years, practically speaking. But within all the states of consciousness. So our material conditioned states of consciousness are analyzed as three: wakefulness, dreaming, and deep sleep, or unconsciousness. And that all of these are manifestations of the Lord. Because Lord says, Bhumir apanalovayu kam mano buddhir evacha. So the mind and the intelligence are also the Lord's energy. And when the Lord met the gopis at Kurukshetra, he said that whatever you're thinking must be me. Prabhupada writes there in the Krishna book that we cannot think of anything beyond the Lord's energy. Is there anything we can think of beyond the Lord's energy? We can combine it in some funny way in our mind and think about, you know, flying rabbits or something like that. But the concept of flying and the concept of rabbits is within the Lord's energy. And therefore, everything we think of is ultimately the Lord, because the Lord and his energy are non-different. Our ability to think, matasmatir gyanam apohanam cha, that is also coming from the Lord. So our intelligence, knowledge, and forgetfulness, our thinking ability, the ability in human beings, the substance of the mind itself, is all Krishna. Therefore, in all states of consciousness, that is the Lord. The Lord is there. And Krishna also says, among the senses, I am the mind. Yes, in the Bhagavad Gita. He is the chief among the senses. So we can understand who God is in that way, by our consciousness. By our consciousness, there is also God, no matter how our consciousness is manifested. Even in deep sleep, there's some consciousness. I mean, we may say one is unconscious. But Prabhupada gives the example that you can say, I slept soundly. So that means there was some sense of I, even in the so-called deep sleep or unconscious state. And that Krishna is also beyond them. We say Turiya, which literally means the fourth. That Krishna is also in a fourth state of consciousness, beyond wakefulness, dreaming, and deep sleep. In fact, our wakefulness state can be said to be the furthest from spirituality. You know that Krishna often appears to devotees in their sleep, in their dreams, because they're more accessible at that point. we think of our waking state as being our most spiritual, our most conscious, but factually, it's the opposite. The most spiritual state of consciousness is when the mind and intelligence have stopped their activities and the soul is active. Of course, when we go into deep sleep, our mind and intelligence stop and our soul is not active. You know, everything's inactive. But in the Ashtanga Yoga system, pratyahara. Pratyahara means stopping of all of the activities of the senses and stopping the activities of the subtle senses, the mind and the intelligence, and just on the platform of the soul. Now, ordinary yogis and hypnotists, they will do things like stop the mind. If you've ever seen people in a state of deep hypnosis, what they've done is they've basically put the mind to sleep. The mind has the accepting and rejecting feature. So when the hypnotist says to someone, you know, you are a rabbit, because the mind is sleeping and the acceptance rejections is turned off, they don't reject it. Do you understand? They just accept, okay, I'm a rabbit, and they act like a rabbit. For an ordinary conditioned soul, if you also turn off the intelligence, then they don't know how to function anymore. But for the great yogis, they would turn off the mind and turn off the intelligence and function on the platform of the soul. And generally, they would do it first by fixing the mind. The intelligence tends to be very fixed. And gradually, they would dissolve these and reach another state of consciousness called trance or samadhi. There's also a mental samadhi. There's a samadhi of the mind and the intelligence, and there's a samadhi beyond the mind and intelligence. So Krishna exists in all of these states of consciousness. Then he also exists within the heart. He is the life of the life. We call him Paramatma. Paramatma means the super soul, the super self, the self of the self. We are attached to this body and we are attached to this mind because I am within the body and the mind. When we leave the body and the mind, we don't have so much attachment. Just unless you're very unfortunate and hang around as a ghost. But generally, we don't have much attachment. You read many times in near-death experiences, the person leaves the body and they're looking down and saying, oh, that person's in bad shape down there. Yeah. Oh, that's my body. You know, and they don't even have it. They lose their sense of identification with it. So we are attached to this body and mind because we are there. And factually, we are attached to ourself because Krishna is there. Krishna is the self of the self. And in everyone's heart. And then, regardless of all of these, there is God beyond. So the purpose of knowing the truth here, as discussed in the last paragraph of this purport, is not just so we can figure out how to manipulate this material world to be happy. Generally, religious people want to know God, know the truth, so that they can use this world for their own happiness. Such is the general goal of all the religious systems in the world. I'm going to figure out the truth, the real truth, the absolute truth, and then I can be the enjoyer of the world. That's called Sakama Devotee. And all the way up to the great demigods, this is the mood. And if you go to any religious system, you'll find that that is their mood, generally speaking. Or their mood is, I'll know the truth so I can get out of the world. I was just speaking to a devotee yesterday who was saying, oh, I'm in so much pain, just get me out, just get me out, just get me out. So we're going to be giving our seminar here in Raghunath Das Goswami's Manashiksha. And that kind of talking, Raghunath Das Goswami compares to a tigress who will eat your very self. The material world is miserable, I want to get out. Huh? But most people use religion for these ideas. Either I want to enjoy the world by the grace of God, or I want to get out of the world by the grace of God because it's not very enjoyable. So here is another alternative. One wants to know these things, not so, okay, now I know the truth, I can use the truth to enjoy or to escape, but let me know the truth so I can love the truth. So I can love the truth. Instead of loving my own happiness, let me love the truth. And if I love the truth, then I will find far greater happiness than trying to use the truth for my own happiness. And therefore, this purport ends so beautifully with a discussion of the different manifestations of the Lord. Yes? Right. Lord Nrisimhadev saving his devotee, Ramachandra is the perfect king, Krishna stealing the hearts of everybody. So our purpose in knowing the truth is so we can find the supreme happiness. The supreme happiness isn't just knowing what to eat and knowing what college to go to and knowing whether or not to get married. That's not the supreme happiness. The supreme happiness isn't like that. Or even in just realizing ourself and getting salvation from this wretched material body in Kali Yuga on this lowest of the middle planets in this smallest of the universes of Lord Brahma. It isn't just about that. It's really about finding the greatest happiness, which everybody knows is in love. Whenever any of us have been in love, even with something ordinary in this world, even if you're in love with your latest phone or something, then that's a kind of perverted shantaras. When we're in love with something or someone, then yes, we feel a really special kind of happiness, don't we? We become very absorbed in that which we love, and we feel that nothing matters in the world, that everybody can go on fighting and killing each other and screaming about this and that. And it doesn't matter as long as we have that which or that whom we love. Isn't that a fact? Have all of us been in love with somebody or something in our life, albeit briefly? Uh-huh. And in that love, one feels like that. And it really doesn't matter, again, whatever one's loving. One may love one's work. One may love one's objects. One may love one's dog. One may love one's spouse or one's children or one's parents or one's institution or one's nation. But if we start feeling this kind of love, then we forget everything else and we don't care about anything else. And we're willing to sacrifice anything for what we love. Isn't that true? Yes. So knowing God and knowing the truth ultimately is so we can repose our love in the source of everything. And knowing that Krishna is the Hetu, the source of everything, is not just so we have a very good philosophical grasp on what's going on here, but also so we can say, goodness, if I can feel this much happiness and transcendence and detachment very temporarily when I love my new phone or I love my dog or I love my job, just imagine how much I would feel if I was in love with the source of all of these things. You know, how much we are able to transcend and sacrifice and get detachment when we are in love with some other living being or some object or some work in this world. And to multiply that by uncountable times for the source of everything. And how would we feel then? How much would we transcend? How much would we be detached? How much would the world could fall apart? And we wouldn't care. It wouldn't matter to us as long as we had our beloved. And this is the ultimate reason for wanting to know the truth. And this is the ultimate reason for the Bhagavatam. And this is the ultimate goal which all of us seek. This total consuming love for the cause of all causes, the ultimate repository of everything. You know, if we can have so much love for some little piece of metal and plastic in this world, and this is a very insignificant world, in a very insignificant universe. So imagine how attractive is the cause of all of the universes, all of the worlds, all of the objects, all of the living entities. So that is why we want to know God. We don't want to know God simply to be big philosophers. And just so we have the most thorough and most accurate and most satisfying philosophy, which indeed we do. But that's not why we want to know it. We want to know it so that we can fall in love. And we should not be afraid of this love. I was just, again, speaking to a devotee yesterday who said, no, I don't like to really study anything about love of God. That's too high. But that's what we're here for. We have to allow ourselves, when we read these descriptions of the Lord, we read these descriptions of the truth, we have to allow our emotions to engage, not just our intellect. If we only allow our intellect to engage, so we may go to the higher planets of the rishis, you know, but we're not going to go to the paravyom. We're not going to go to the supreme sky, where there is not just intellectuals and philosophers, but there are those who are in love with the Lord. So we should be studying and reading with that in mind. So questions, comments, additions, subtractions? Yes. All right, Krishna.
Hare Krishna, talking about contextual truth and the absolute truth.
Mm.
So I absolutely believe Srimad Bhagavatam and Gita to be the absolute truth, but how do I explain it to the other person that this is not a contextual truth?
Oh, such a good question. everything in the Shastra is absolutely true, but most of it is absolutely true in context.
So this person says, for you, it could be fine as a contextual truth and the absolute truth being one. For me, as you say...
Well, therefore, one has to have a guru, and one has to have sadhus. Shastra alone is not the answer. You cannot rely only on the Shastra.
So I need to tell that person that you also need to have a guru to understand...
Guru and sadhus. You must have all three, guru, sadhu, shastra. Because guru says, this statement in the Shastra, just like Krishna says, Arjuna, pick up your bow and fight. Is that the instruction for you? Do you have a bow? It's not your instruction. Okay, everybody, right after class, go get your bows and arrows.
Yeah!
And go fight Dronacharya. I don't see him. What happened to my chariot? Somebody stole my chariot. Oh my God, what am I going to do? So that is in that specific instruction is for Arjuna, it's not for you. But Krishna's instruction, mam anusmam yujicha, think of me and fight. But I'm not in a fight. So I have to go fight now? Okay, guys, get ready. Some devotees seem to take this quite literally. I'm sorry, that was terrible, wasn't it? And think, you know, that's the purpose of the Krishna consciousness movement. Think of Krishna and fight with the other devotees about everything. So that's... But the principle there, so that's a very contextual instruction. Think of me and fight is a very time, place, and circumstance instruction. The principle is think of me while you're doing whatever you're doing. That's the non-contextual principle. But to understand that, you have to have a guru. You have to have sadhus. How did Rupa Goswami and Jiva Goswami, Bhakti Siddhanta, how did they understand mam anusmam yujicha? What did that mean to them? How did they apply that? And without guru and sadhus, you can't do it. So most of the instructions of the scriptures and the sadhus and the acharyas are in response to a particular time, place, and circumstance, the vast majority. And then there are certain instructions and certain statements that are applicable without, they're applicable to all time, place, and circumstances, and all persons. And which are the ones that are applicable in all circumstances, and which are the ones that are applicable in a certain circumstance? And you have to go underneath and find what is the principle, what is the universal principle behind that time, place, and circumstance. For that, we need guidance. Therefore, one must have guru. It's necessary. One has to have guru. And one has to have sadhus. You can't only have guru, you can't only have sadhus, you can't only have scripture, you have to have all. Is that okay?
Hare Krishna, but like when we give a book to somebody, he says, okay, this is intelligence, I believe it.
Okay.
But this is not my faith. So then I tell him, you have to find a guru to have your belief as your faith. Like when we give a book, we are normally giving spiritual intelligence to somebody.
He said, this is not my faith, this is what I don't believe in. Well, I was going to say, how do you know whether or not you believe in it until you've read it? They said they've already read it?
Yeah, say if I've read it, I believe what it says, but that's not my faith.
But that's... I believe what it says, but it's not my faith?
Normally people say...
I don't understand that.
Normally people accept a book. When we give a book, we're giving a book as the absolute truth. We're giving it as spiritual intelligence.
Well, then I would say to that person, okay, well, what is your faith?
What is your faith?
And try to work with him with that. Just like Srila Prabhupada was, if people were attached to their particular designation, I'm a Protestant, I'm a Catholic, I'm a Sunni, I'm a Shiite, whatever, then he'd say, okay, if you don't want to follow in this way, then follow in that way. Then pray to Jesus, pray to Allah. You know, that's all right. We accept that. I mean, I know initiated devotees who are, you know, working as, they're also living in a Catholic monastery as a Catholic monk while they're initiated devotees. So, You don't have to, you know, telling people you have to change your faith and convert to a new religion, if that's what you're talking about.
Well, I never heard something like that, but then.
Oh, Prabhupada said that many times. He's saying we're not trying to change people from Christians to Hindus. You know, I said that, how my father said I'm not a Hare Krishna devotee. Prabhupada said that's okay. Every genuine religion is teaching to know and love God. You don't have to change your religion. So we're not telling people to change their faith. And frankly, even some of what we consider our core tenets are not absolutely necessary. You can still love God even if you don't believe in karma and reincarnation. You can. We don't require that. We don't go to the Christians and say, you have to believe in karma and reincarnation in order to love God. Do you follow? Does that make sense to you? And if they love Jesus, he'll help them. If they love Muhammad, he'll help them. Prabhupada would sometimes say, in regard to the first offense on chanting, he said, not to blaspheme devotees of the Lord who dedicated their lives to propagation of the Holy Name. He said, this applies to Jesus and Muhammad. Don't blaspheme them. If they have some other guru that's bona fide, I mean, if they have a bogus guru, that's something else. You know, there are cheating religions, out and out cheating religions. Just like there's cheating universities, you know, pay £100 and get your PhD. So that's not going to help anybody. But we don't say you have to go to Oxford. There's Cambridge too, you know, and even, perish the thought, there's even American universities. And French ones, and you know, they're not all British. So it's not that you can get a degree from the Sorbonne, you know, you don't have to go to Oxford. You can even get a degree from the University of Pennsylvania. Truth is truth. We're not requiring people to change their faith. You know, you have some ugly guy with a backache saying he's God, you know, that's another problem. That's different. You know, well, here's my God. And you would say, well, you know, as far as I know, God is the most beautiful, and I don't know if this guy qualifies. That's another issue. But if you have a bona fide guru and you're in a bona fide religious tradition, that's fine. Then we'll encourage you. Then chant the name of God that's in your scriptures and dedicate yourself to your tradition and go deep into your tradition and find what is the essence of your tradition. And you'll find in all these traditions you get to the essence again you can to love of God. Is that okay? Anybody else? Yes?
Thank you. I wanted to ask that it was mentioned that the material universe exists because we had a pre-existing desire to be separate.
Yes.
If I understand it.
Correct.
But I also heard somewhere else that for a soul to fall down, they have to turn away from Krishna and look at the material energy, which would mean
how can they look at it if it's not there?
If it's not there, because they get the desire from looking at it.
Okay.
So I don't really know how material energy comes to be.
Okay, well, my problem here is that it is 8:43. And you asked a question that people have been debating and discussing for decades. And there is simply no way that I'm going to be able to answer it satisfactorily. I will try in 1 or 2 minutes, but I will tell you that if you're not satisfied with my answer, and you probably won't be, there is a lot more that you can read on this subject. The simple, very simple answer I will give you right now, this is not a comprehensive answer by any means, is that you're trying to put in time something that's beyond time. You're mixing a state that has no past, present, and future with a state that has a creation and destruction in past, present, and future. And you're trying to fit those two together, and you can't, because they won't fit together like that in a temporal sense. And a lot of the problems that people have with, you know, how did we get here, and what was the cause, is because they're trying to fit into time something that's beyond time. And something that's beyond time, when we talk about a cause and effect, a cause and effect implies time, that the cause happens first and then the effect happens. If they both exist simultaneously, it's hard for us to understand cause and effect. I mean, we can understand a little bit, like the sun is the cause of the sunshine. But this, it's not that first there was a sun and then there was sunshine later. Unless there was sunshine, there was no sun. In order for it to be a sun, it has to have sunshine. And yet the sun is the cause of the sunshine. That's a little bit of an idea of something that doesn't have a time, a past and future and present, and still one thing is the cause of another. So the spiritual world, time is conspicuous by its absence. There's no past and future. So how can a soul make a decision that leads to something in a world that has no past and future? That doesn't... What do we do with that? We can't really. So when you try to explain, well, the material world is created and destroyed, so there might be some soul in the spiritual world who wanted to come down at a time when the universe was destroyed and there was no universe to look at. So I guess when the universe is destroyed, nobody can fall because I have to wait till there's a universe to look at. But that's a very, the lens through which we're seeing that kind, which is a very intelligent and thoughtful question, by the way. But the lens through which you're asking that question is a lens of past, present, and future. And it's trying to put something in a box that really doesn't fit into that box. And because of this basic problem, that we're talking about something that's beyond time, and yet we're trying to talk about cause and effect. I'm convinced that's one of the reasons why this is a very difficult, this particular question of how did this whole thing start for me, is a very, very, very difficult one to answer. However you answer it puts you in some sort of a mental circle. And however you answer it puts you into something that's inconceivable and something that just doesn't add up. In principle, you can say that my existence here has to be either my fault or somebody else's fault, or nobody's fault. Does that sound like our options? The fact that I'm here, either it's nobody's fault at all, and we talk about fault because being here is not particularly pleasant most of the time. Am I the only one who has that experience? So it's either just nobody's fault, or it's my fault, or somebody else's fault. So nobody's fault means that either there's nobody running anything, or whoever's running everything is just sort of detached, or whoever's running everything is, there's something wrong with them. So that's one philosophy. If it's somebody else's fault, then there's something wrong with fairness and justice in reality. If it's God's fault, there's something wrong with God. Why would God take me and put me here? And put me in this situation of this, you know, old decaying sick body in this old decaying sick planet. You know, why would he do that? So then I have a real problem with God. Then God, why would I love him? It seemed that I would actually hate him and resent him. And, you know, there's all these fictional stories of like that, that this world is some kind of an illusion created by machines or created by alien beings to just suck out all of our energy and torture us, right? Are there fictional stories like that?
Yeah.
Yes. So that's this idea of this malevolent God who's put me here under illusion and suffering for some malevolent purpose. And then there's, well, it's my fault. Well, if it's my fault, my problem with that is that it doesn't seem to me that I would choose what I'm experiencing. That doesn't seem to me to make any sense. I would like to think of myself as far more rational and intelligent and discriminating than that I would have chosen this life and this body and this planet and so forth. So I either have to say that the whole creation is senseless, or somebody is evil and has evil intentions, or that I'm a fool. Of the three, I would prefer to think that I'm a fool. Why would I prefer to think that I'm a fool? Well, first of all, it means that the universe makes a lot of sense. And I would prefer to think that the universe makes sense. Also, I prefer to think that whoever's running things is kind. If who's ever running everything is not kind, then you're really in trouble. What are you going to do? If there's nobody running everything, what are you going to do? what's your option? Suicide, I mean. Well, what is your option? If I'm a fool, that can be fixed, hopefully. If I'm the one responsible, then that means I have agency, and that means I can do something about it, and that's very exciting to me. If the problem is with God, I can't do anything about it. If the problem is just there's nobody in charge, I can't do anything about that. If the problem is me, I can fix me. And it also means that the universe is fair and orderly and meaningful. So I prefer that option for those reasons, even if I can't really understand how it is that I'm such a fool, because I don't think I'm such a fool. I think I'm a highly intelligent, rational being. I do. I don't think I'm foolish at all. I mean, occasionally it's right in front of my nose, and I have to say, well, yeah, okay. But that seems to me to be the most reasonable option. Now, how exactly I'm a fool and how exactly I made in the past a foolish choice and how exactly I am making at this present moment a foolish choice, that's another question which I think becomes revealed to us as we chant Hare Krishna with sincerity, you know, or maybe even without so much sincerity. But as you chant Hare Krishna, it starts to, one of the things that will start to become obvious to you, and if you don't like this idea, you probably should stop chanting Hare Krishna. Or you can keep chanting Hare Krishna but offend devotees, because then it won't be very effective. But if you want to chant Hare Krishna and not offend devotees, then one of the things that you will start seeing is that you are a royal certified idiot. It will become more and more obvious to you day by day that you're not really intelligent and rational and that you really are just, you know, absolutely certified, stamped, you know, fool. And you'll see it for yourself, which is quite disconcerting, frankly. It really is. It's quite disconcerting. It gives you a lot of cognitive dissonance at first, because it's quite opposite to our ahankara. It's really very, very much the opposite. You know, ahankara is I am perfect, powerful, and happy, and I'm competent, and I'm expert, and I'm together, and, you know, and I'm together in Krishna consciousness. I was together materially, and now I'm together in Krishna consciousness, and I'm a good devotee, and all this kind of stuff. And as you chant, if you don't offend devotees, you will see this, that all that's a lie, and it's not true, and you really are choosing to be in Maya right now. It wasn't just something that you did in the spiritual world a long time ago when the material world was destroyed, and so you really didn't have a chance because you couldn't really see what it was, and somehow you jumped without knowing what you were jumping to, and so you really weren't to blame at all for the whole thing. And you'll see that you're doing it right now in this moment, that I'm choosing to rebel against Krishna right now because I'm a flaming idiot. And you'll see that, and you'll have to look at it and say, oh, gosh. Well, now what do I do about that? And that's how I really look at the whole question, that it's really irrelevant what I did 10 billion years ago. It's really what's relevant is what am I doing now at 8:52 when I have to stop the class. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Thank you, Mother Amala, for the class. Hare Krishna, thank you for coming to Soho Street again. Thank you for coming to Soho Street.
Oh, my pleasure.
Looking forward to hearing from you more. So we have some Sankirtan results from yesterday on book distribution. We have Bhakti and Gabriella, 13 Lakshmi, 3 small, 6 medium books for 5.75 book points. Vayudas, 60 Lakshmi, 16 small, 23 medium, 5 Mahabik for 25.5 book points. And Vishwari Gaurangadas, 60 Lakshmi, 6 small, 11 medium, 11 Mahabik for 29 book points. And in Radha's boutique, yesterday, 3 books were distributed for 102 Lakshmi points. And in Closet Krishna, 100 Lakshmi, 1 small book, 3 medium, and 1 big book. So we'll just say our prayer before we serve prasadam. Are there any volunteers who would like to serve prasadam this morning in the restaurant? 1, 2, 3, 4. And would anyone like to volunteer cleaning the restaurant, giving the tables a quick wipe after we take prasadam? Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So we'll say the prayer. Dishi Shiva Landishwara. Jagannath Baladev and Subhadra. Shishi Goranatai. And Giri Govardhan. We offer our most respectful obeisances unto you. In a mood of deep gratitude and appreciation, we request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, if you so desire, we wish to erect the holy place of your transcendental pastimes that will attract unlimited souls to your service and fulfill the vision of your pure devotee Srila Prabhupada for London. Please enable us to cooperate together in order to satisfy you in this way. We, the surrendered servants of your servants, humbly beg. New temple for the Lordship's key. Prasadam key. Jainitai Gaur Premanandi.
Fasting and staying up all night, and he said something like,